Welcome to the Nightly Five podcast with Bel Taylor.
On today's show, a possible breakthrough in the case of Samantha Murphy as Victoria Police launch a search operation in the Ballarat area. Calls grow for Immigration Minister Andrew Giles to be sacked over the latest visa scandal. April's inflation figures are higher than expected, leading to predictions the Australian Reserve Bank will keep interest rates on hold. West Australian police respond to claims by the daughter of double murderer Mark Bombara that her concerns were ignored by authorities. And Aussie rockers Cold Chisel announce a massive national tour. In our top story today, a potential breakthrough in the case of Samantha Murphy.
The search has resumed for missing Ballarat mother Samantha Murphy. Victorian police undertaking a targeted search in the Ballarat area today. The missing persons squad, as well as a range of specialist resources, are there. The 51-year-old was last seen leaving her family home for a run on February 4th.
Victoria Police have launched a search operation in the Ballarat area, including bringing in an excavator as part of their ongoing investigation into the disappearance of Samantha Murphy. 51-year-old mother Miss Murphy was last seen on the 4th of February as she departed her home for her routine morning jog. The dog squad and an excavator have been seen near Buninyong, a location where cellular phone towers reportedly last pinged Ms. Murphy's phone. Detectives from the missing persons squad and specialised units were also part of Wednesday's search efforts. Patrick Orong Stevenson, aged 22, has been formally charged with murder in connection to Ms. Murphy's disappearance.
The Immigration Minister, Andrew Giles, will be fighting to keep his job this morning with revelations he was warned about the implications of his controversial decision that allowed a host of dangerous criminals to stay in our country.
After a week with the opposition calling for his sacking, it has been announced that Immigration Minister Andrew Giles will issue a new directive designed to prevent convicted criminals from having their visa cancellations overturned. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese announced the decision at the start of question time on Wednesday as the government scrambled to extinguish the latest immigration scandal. Mr. Albanese said that the new direction would clarify that the protection of the community outweighed all other considerations when the Administrative Appeals Tribunal ruled on visa cancellation decisions. Joining me now is the Nightly's political reporter Dan Jarvis Bardi. Dan, will this directive put a hold on the criticisms that we have seen levelled at the Immigration Minister this week?
I certainly don't think it will stop the attacks from the coalition, but it is a bit of a circuit breaker for the government. There's, well, you've seen over the past couple of days a series of very politically damaging stories for the government as more examples of these cases in which, you know, individuals who'd convicted horrific crimes that had their visa cancellations overturned because of this Direction 99, as it's called, that was issued by Andrew Giles. And what we've seen is these cases, like I said, continue to emerge, build up one after another. And it was really, you know, the situation was becoming quite toxic for the government. Now, they've made a decision today, and it is relatively quick decision to issue the new direction. The hope is that it means that as these cases come before the tribunal in the future, that hopefully the same decisions won't be made. So I think they've certainly moved to try and put a band-aid on the wound. Whether or not it stops the bleeding in the long term, we'll have to wait and see.
What does a directive mean, Dan? Like, can they just say to the administrative tribunal, hey, stop doing this? Is that what a directive is, or are they going to turn this into law?
Essentially, so what it is it's basically instructions for the Administrative Appeals Tribunal as they're considering cases and they're trying to weigh up whether or not this visa cancellation should remain or whether it should be overturned. What they'll have to do now as they weigh up the different decisions is they will have to prioritise the protection of the community above all other considerations. So if you sort of consider a practical example, if you've got someone that has been convicted of murder, for instance, and they've, you know, potentially there is a risk of reoffending, they will have to consider as part of their decision-making process, if we decide to overturn the cancellation, are we potentially putting the community at risk? So no, it's not legally binding, but it's essentially giving a very strong direction to these tribunal members that this is how we want you to decide cases. And the reason that this issue has, or this scandal has erupted and all of these cases have emerged, is because of the way that those tribunal members were interpreting a previous direction and essentially, you know, giving a bit more leniency to people in these cases.
Well, I'm sure this story's got some way to go yet, Dan. Thank you so much for joining me today.
My pleasure.
As I've said, they did not assist in getting us a temporary protective order. They felt that the threat of the guns was scary enough to call for backup and put on their vests, but they didn't think the threat was enough to actually confiscate those guns or do anything.
That was Ariel Bombara, daughter of double murderer Mark Bombara, who killed two women in a Perth suburb on Friday. WA Police Commissioner Cole Blanch responded to Ariel's statement on Perth Radio on Wednesday morning.
To say that nothing was done is wrong. A lot was done.
Commissioner Cole Blanch said in the weeks leading up to the shooting, two family violence information reports were completed in relation to the family, and at least one of those reports was forwarded to a third party for further possible action. Ariel Bombara says she raised serious concerns about the imminent threat her father posed as early as March 30, but she says her warnings, which were relayed to male WA police officers, were repeatedly ignored. Ms. Bombara also said she told police she wished to take out a 72-hour temporary protective order against her father, but her request was rejected. Commissioner Blanch has now flagged possible changes to the threshold needed to impose 72-hour temporary protective orders, of which about 25,000 are issued each year. Mr. Blanch said he was in favour of lowering the threshold needed to impose temporary protective orders and said he has already spoken to the WA Police Minister about the issue.
You're listening to The Nightly Five.
Inflation has come in hotter than usual over April on the back of higher new housing prices and an increase in food prices. This might be bad news at the supermarket checkout, but economists are saying it may mean the Reserve Bank of Australia will need to keep interest rates on hold for longer. Over the year to April, inflation on a monthly basis was 3.6%, up from 3.5% in March, and higher than consensus economic forecasts for 3.4%. When price volatile items such as petrol and food are excluded, inflation held steady at 4.1%. Joining me now is senior business reporter Adrian Lowe. Adrian, what does it all mean?
Belle, it means that if you've got a mortgage, you're going to be paying that higher mortgage monthly repayment that you've been making for a little while for a bit longer. So remember, the Reserve Bank put up rates to 4.35% in November. They haven't moved on rates this year. A lot of people were expecting rate cuts might come by September, October, because inflation was starting to slow in the first 3 months of the year. We're not getting that now. What we're seeing is inflation is proving really persistent. It's like that X that just won't let you go. It is hanging around. It's holding on to you. It's holding firm and it's not letting go. When you have the Reserve Bank governor standing up in front of the media after rates go stay on hold and saying that even she got a shock at the price of petrol, then you know that we've got a situation that's pretty uncomfortable.
Yeah. So your X is like a $5 capsicum, is what you're saying.
Essentially. Now, the thing to remember is things like food and petrol and other, as you said, volatile price items, and volatile because their price can move pretty easily. When that's excluded, underlying inflation, which is what the RBA looks at, is still at 4.1%. Now, it's holding pretty steady at 4. Now, that sounds kind of low compared to what we were talking about a couple of years back when it was nearly 8%. But remember, the Reserve Bank targets 2 to 3%. And getting it lower into that 2 to 3% is proving really difficult at the moment because we've got things like insurance and we've got things like rents and the cost of new housing construction that are really showing no sign of abating. Those costs are almost, it feels like, baked in into the economy at the moment.
Oh, absolutely. At the water cooler and at the school gate, there's one topic only, isn't it? And it's how expensive everything is, Adrian. So people are really hurting. Everyone I speak to has cut back on their spending. So what's driving this inflation?
It really is those things like insurance and the housing construction rents. And the problem is there's really little anyone, individual person, can do about that at the moment. And I think that's what the Reserve Bank is now really cognizant of. This has gone beyond things that consumers can do. I think at the start, of this inflation going up, people were concerned that people wouldn't pull back spending because we'd had the COVID good times. And I hate using that expression, but financially for the economy, things were relatively good on an economic level. You know, people had jobs, people had stimulus money. We weren't traveling, so we were spending our online shopping or our online, you know, booze, things like that. And we weren't pulling back as quickly as I think people would have liked. Now we're in a situation where everyone has gotten concerned. Rents have really spiked. Mortgages have spiked. People have pulled back, but it's proving really persistent. So things like your health insurance, your car insurance, even getting your car repaired is getting a lot more expensive. And I think the Reserve Bank is very concerned to not raise rates again if it can help it, because it knows consumers can't do much about this. What will have to happen are things like potentially things like corporate tax cuts, which the industry minister talked about yesterday, to kind of get companies spending and using a bit more money. That is probably sounds counterintuitive, but it means that it frees up the economy. You get investment into things. The government will say that their measures like bringing electricity prices down will help the headline inflation. It probably will to some extent, but the question is, it's going to probably be quite underlying. So they need to be looking at other things they can do to you know, make sure that the government policies aren't going against what the Reserve Bank is trying to do.
Great. Thanks so much for that, Adrian. I feel a lot more cognizant of inflation.
You're welcome.
Thanks so much.
No worries.
They have everything we want. They've got just what we need. Yes, Cold Chisel are hitting the road. The Aussie rockers have announced they are touring the country to celebrate their golden 50th anniversary. The Big 5-0 tour will take place in October and November throughout the nation. Lead singer Jimmy Barnes has said that he's looking forward to getting back out on the road with Don Walker, Ian Moss, Phil Smoore and drummer Charlie Drayton. The band, he says, has defined his life. Here with me today is music critic and, I'm guessing, a Cold Chisel fan, Simon Collins. Simon, how excited are Cold Chisel fans around the nation this morning?
Probably very excited. It's going to be a big big end of the year for them. Plenty, not just the tour, but also another best of out in multiple vinyl formats to go with the, you know, the 2011 CD best of. So you get another copy of all these tracks.
Exactly. I mean, surely if you're a Cold Chisel fan, you've already got all those songs, right, on CD and in vinyl. Like, you couldn't possibly be needing any more. Or is that a furphy?
Well, they've released, like, I think, 9 compilations, including platinum-selling best ofs in, like, 91 and then 2011, and that one was re-released in 2018. But this one, because, you know, now the CD's kind of dead and we're on vinyl's the big format, this will probably have several different versions in different colours and things like that for the collectors. I think that's out around late August, just before, like, you know, right in time for Father's Day.
All right. And this is actually also exciting news, because late last year, Jimmy Barnes had open heart surgery. We're all a bit nervous about, you know, for him. And now he's back on the road.
He's back. He's like the Keith Richards of Australian rock. He cannot be killed.
We're very happy about that.
He had serious heart. We're stoked about it. He had heart surgery, you know, late last year, and now he's going to hit the road for I think they're sort of keeping it a pretty gentle pace, but these concerts will be massive. And he still, you know, despite the doctor's orders, he still doesn't hold anything back on stage. It's, you know, it's that Galforth voice that he used to make, you know, Chisel a great band during that pub rock era.
Yeah, I'm assuming you've seen Cold Chisel in concert before, Simon?
A few times, a little bit before me, and, you know, I actually wasn't a massive fan. There's a lot of bands of that early pub rock era where it took a little bit of time to appreciate them because of the fact that they would play these great songs, but they would kind of, you know, Barnsley would belt them out, you know, sort of scream them out, and you sort of lost some of the subtlety. But that was how you had to perform in those eras where, you know, there was, you know, they played to packed, you know, pubs where they had to play above the din of drinkers and fights and whatever else was going on.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose...
But they're great. They're great songs. These songs like Flame Trees and Kaysan and Forever Now.
Well, that's just it. Do you think there was a bit of snobbery in the past, but now people are kind of going back to those songs and realising that songs like Flame Trees are beautiful songs.
Yeah, and that's written by Steve Prestwich, who's the original drummer, or the main drummer. who passed away in 2011, and you know, had a pretty good record. He only wrote a few songs for Chisel, but they're Flame Trees and When the War is Over and Forever Now, which are three of the best, which is not bad in a band. We've got Don Walker and Ian Moss and Jimmy Barnes in there writing songs as well.
Yeah.
But they're beautiful songs, and they're like, you know, they're ballads, but, you know, they weren't as pop as In Excess, and they weren't as political as Midnight Oil, but they had a lot of truth and a lot of soul to what they sung about. And, you know, John Walker's a fantastic writer, great observer of Australian life. They wrote some great ballads. I mean, yeah, it is really hard to go past Flame Trees. It's just an incredible song about someone going home and reconnecting and loss and love and and nostalgia all tangling.
And you've got artists like Sarah Blasco doing covers of it,
yes,
which is something you perhaps wouldn't have predicted when that song first came out, that artists like Sarah Blasco would be doing these kind of really heartfelt covers of Cold Chisel songs.
Yeah, that's a standout one, just because she just imbued the song with so much melancholy. It's a fantastic cover, but I mean, I think, you know, it's a terrific song and, you know, well-structured and you know, they're a great band. I mean, it's funny, this is the 50th anniversary, right? But they actually formed in 73, but this is, they're kind of hinging this off them sort of becoming Cold Chisel, because they originally, when they formed in Adelaide in 73, they were called Orange, and they became Chisel in 74, Cold Chisel in 74. And they're living in Armidale while Don Walker was finishing uni, doing a Bachelor of Science.
Yeah.
With honours. So they're kind of thought of as being these rough and ready, hard drinking, hard living, you know, blokes or bogan from Adelaide. But they were, you know, there's much more to Chisel than, you know, a sweaty Jimmy Barnes clutching a bottle of vodka on stage.
Yeah, they're thinking bogans band.
Well, he's now a Buddhist and off the booze. So, you know, it has been for a long time. So, you know, they've sort of Australia sort of grown up with them, I think.
Oh, absolutely. Look, I think a lot of people will be really looking forward to this concert.
It'll be a big day.
Yeah, cool. Thanks so much for that, Simon.
Pleasure.
And that's today's show. Thank you so much for joining me. Don't forget to subscribe wherever you get your podcasts, and you can join Ben O'Shea tomorrow on The Nightly Five.
The Nightly Five podcast is brought to you by 7 West Media. For all these stories and more, head to thenightly.com.au, helping you get in front of tomorrow.